بسم الله الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى، وصلاة الله وسلامه على رسوله المصطفى وحبيبه المجتبى وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اتبع الهدى. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. الحمد لله. All praises be to Allah سبحانه وتعالى who has granted us the opportunity to perform our Isha prayers in congregation Jama'ah and followed by our Taraweeh prayers as mentioned by Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam in a hadith narrated by Imam al-Bukhari and Imam al-Muslim. Whoever prays Isha in congregation, it is as though he has kept vigil, meaning pray all night, pray half of the night. And whoever performs the subuh or the fajr prayers in congregation in jama'ah, it is as though he has performed vigil. He has, meaning he has performed ibadah throughout the night, as if he has performed ibadah throughout the night. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us through our small deeds of the congregation prayers, these deeds, this reward, and may we be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us his jannah. Ameen ya rabbal alamin. Jemaah, ibu dan bapak-bapak, brothers, first and foremost, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Tonight we are gathered here in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in what I call his spring of knowledge and spring of noon. This house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so secret, suci sana, to the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises those who build a house for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or contributes, menyumbang to the building of a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prepare for him a house for us to dwell and to sit in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's jannah forever and for perpetuity. Brothers, tonight I'm asked to discuss about a very, very relevant and important topic. The topic of Al-Quran and how we understand and practice Al-Quran. But that has to start with the first prerequisite, the first condition, which is love for Al-Quran Al-Karim. If we look at how majestic Al-Quran Al-Karim, how revered Al-Quran Al-Karim, if you notice, I've read many times in Taraweeh, the Taraweeh that we have just performed, Surah Inna Anzalnahu Fi Laylatil Qadr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily we, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have revealed the Surah, the Quran al-Karim, who? Fi Laylatil Qadr, on the night of Al-Qadr. Some ulama, as mentioned by Imam al-Tabari in his tafsir, mentions that one of the main reasons why Al-Qadr, the night of Al-Qadr, happens is not because only of Laylatul Qadr, but there's a reason. It is there to celebrate the revelation of the greatest word that human will ever see after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Laylatul Qadr was there as a sign of respect, as a sign of reverence for the very words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will come down from Lawh Mahfuz, the house of secrets, to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And that is one of those reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the same surah, Surah Al-Qadr, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالرُّوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. All angels, including Ar-Ruh, some tafsir Ar-Ruhiyya means or refers to Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, came down accompanying on the night of Laylatul Qadr, guarding Al-Quran Al-Karim so that it may be revealed to the greatest man who is named Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And today, at this very moment, those very books that we see behind or in front, these are the very exact words revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. We admit, kita mengaku that we believe in the Quran al-Karim. Kita percaya dengan Al-Quran al-Karim. But really the question is that we should ask ourselves, how much of the Quran al-Karim do we know? How have we looked at Al-Quran al-Karim? Many a times. Some of you may know Arabic. Most of us may not know Arabic well. And therefore, as a result, when we look at the Quran, we tend to look at the Quran as if it is an alien book. Then you open the Quran, and then you see words. You might know how to recite, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. But you might not necessarily know what a single thing of it means. And that's the challenge with many, many Muslims. Because not many of us are born native speakers of Arabic language. Even native speakers of Arabic language would meet people who still, the experts of Arabic language, the masters of Arabic language, to help them understand Al-Quran al-Karim. Because Al-Quran al-Karim is the epitome of Arabic language. It is the pinnacle of Arabic language standards. When no other book, no other Arabic literature will be able to match. It is so profound, it is so great, the amount of guidance that you can find from Al-Quran al-Karim. It is so revered that in the ayah, in the verse that I've read earlier on in Salat al-Isha, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. If we, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, were to reveal, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ, if we were to reveal this Qur'an, عَلَى جَبَلٍ, on a great mountain, لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا, you will see it bowing, prostrating down. Why? Out of awe, out of fear, out of respect for what is in the Al-Quran al-Karim. Let me ask you a question. Now, some of us may belong from a culture where there is a great sultan or a malik. If that great sultan were to bestow upon you his decree, written, put in a golden scroll, and bestowed upon you, how would you receive it? Would you just come, thank you, sir, you walk off? No, you will come in respect. You will bow before him to receive that decree and scroll. And mind you, that is a decree and scroll written, and probably not written by him also, given by a normal human being. Normal human being who may sin and who will sin. He is not Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's just another king. But yet we accord so much respect and reverence for this golden scroll that we receive from a person of stature. And when we feel and we hold the Al-Quran al-Karim, what do we feel? How do we feel when we hold the Quran al-Karim? So that's the question. And therefore, it's very important for us to know that the Sahabis, the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they were so affected by Quran. The Quran has basically managed to change a whole generation of baby killing people who were cruel, who tortured, who robbed, who killed, who fornicated, performed the zina. But yet, this Quran, this book that we see in front of us here, changed that generation into soft-hearted, loving, compassionate, merciful people who helped the poor and the weak, who lifted oppression, who removed torture, misery from the life of people. Why? Because they were touched by Al-Quran al-Karim. So what were their approach? And what could be our approach today? So this is what we'll have to ask ourselves. And this is the challenge with Muslims sometimes. Because when we approach the Quran, we approach it as if it's an alien book. And when you start approaching the Quran as an alien book, that is when you start to detach yourself. You say, the Quran is just a Quran, it's just a book, I'll read, I'll get rewards, pahala, and that's it. And no more than that, probably. How do we ensure that with our recitation of the Quran, we will fall in love with the Quran? We will have a better understanding and appreciation of the Quran. Now, brothers and sisters, ever so often we start with the reading recitation of Quran, which is important. We know the tajweeds, we know the makharij al-huruf, we know how to pronounce the Quran properly, which is fine, which is important, which is part of learning Al-Quran. But we should not stop there. We should never stop there. That has its own merits, of course. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many hadith explained how so many surahs and verses in the Quran have its own usage, its own benefits to us. For example, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, firstly, as a whole, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, read the Quran, for the Quran will come on the day of judgment shafi'an li sahibihi, as an intercessor, as a recommender, as a referee who will help to push us through into Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's heaven. So then, that's the first whole hadith. But there are many other hadith where Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, for example, read Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Al-Imran, for both of them will come on the day of judgment as something which will cover you, protect you,